Carl Jung was a Swiss psychiatrist that dedicated his entire life to founding analytical psychology. Most people associate the practice with Freud, and for good reason, but truly it was Jung who would propel forward our understanding and thoughts on how and why people behave the way they do. Arguably, Jung's most famous work was a series of self-induced states of sleep paralysis. He performed these for years and recorded the images that he saw. And he used this to argue that the collective unconscious was the foundation of all human understanding. Formulated through archetypes such as the Great Mother, Jung argued that images bled through culture and people, perpetuating our ideas and our beliefs. It's practically impossible to argue its validity, but one thing Jung observed is certain. Images can sit in the subconscious culture of generations of humans, and it's the reason you might think of Coca-Cola when you're shown red and white. It's also the same reason Lynch uses the branding of beers so aggressively in Blue Velvet. Product placement is commonplace for modern audiences, but for Lynch in particular, quite jarring product placement was not a part of his films. It probably comes off more awkward than ever, but the choice to associate characters with certain beer brands in this film isn't for advertisement purposes. Around 3 years ago, Michael Zunenschein wrote a particularly interesting piece for the BFI on the beer's usage in Blue Velvet. He argued that Lynch's choice of beers was startlingly accurate and represented something I'd always thought had had a home in Lynch's odd Lumberton Town Tale, Freud's theory of ego. Michael argued that Jeffrey's Heineken represented the ideals of the ego, approachable, mild-mannered, and curious. It's a normal beer, and it's a way to orientate the viewer between the two lifestyles that take place in Blue Velvet. It's a middle point between Detective Williams' Budweiser superego and Frank Booth's misfit Pabst Blue Ribbon id. Like the ego, Jeffrey is pulled between the higher desire to do good and the baser urges to give into the darkness. It's a convenient metaphor and probably quite an on-the-nose joke from Lynch, but it works. If you want to read the article, I've included it in the description, but it's an excellent entry point to how Jung perceived images and cultural context in the space of Blue Velvet. Whilst the beers may ostensibly be tied to Freudian psychology, they are in fact examples of Jung's work, images that possess unconscious context, and because of that context, create feelings in the conscious mind. It's important to note that Lynch grew up in post-war America and the violence that followed the troops home afterwards. It's something Mark Frost and he shared when they wrote Twin Peaks, and is certainly a theme that's bled into every single one of his films. Whilst Fire Walk With Me is probably his most astute work on the theme, Blue Velvet feels more like a cultural portrait of a young man trying to find his way in a world of stifling oppression and the deeply sadistic response to that oppression. It's applicable to everyone. The audience is Jeffrey Beaumont, both disgusted and intrigued by the darker world of the subconscious that Frank Booth embodies. We're humans, and our morbid curiosity is willing to take us on journeys into the abyss of self because we can trust our superego to make the right decision. One of the most quintessential images of Lynch's childhood era was the white picket fence, a symbol of purity and security that ran deep through the heart of America's subconscious. It's one of the first shots in the film placed within a beautiful montage of protected suburban life. It's these images of firemen waving, children crossing the road, and people watching danger from the comfort of their suburban living room through a television that trigger emotions and a feeling of safety. Before we know it, Lynch takes a dark turn, showcasing the darkness beneath the surface with a haunting transition to the bugs in the undergrowth. It's a scene that's been analysed into the ground, and for good reason. It's arguably one of the fastest depictions of violence under the surface in small-town America. So fast, in fact, that it could be a short film. Yet, nobody really talks about why these images feel the way they do. Nobody except Jung. Jung's theories of image culture are what define these feelings for us. Without a collective unconscious, we wouldn't understand that firemen waving and children crossing the road is safe. Without subconsciously understanding violence on screen is harmless, we would be frightened of this gun. It's a concept Lynch takes in his stride. He's a master of conjuring images that have a deep and meaningful feel to them, even if they're innately just objects. Take for example the juxtaposition of locations between the slow club and the diner. One is significantly more mysterious than the other, darker and sleeker and finished with red velvet curtains, an image Lynch has always used for their transitory nature. Red curtains are both the hiders of the other side, mysterious and commanding, but a gateway once pulled back. Their presence alone invites your curiosity without you realizing. They aren't just curtains, but a question. what's behind the curtains? Even if you don't consciously ask yourself this, Jung would argue that you unconsciously would. Your feelings in the slow club are significantly different than when you're in the diner, an open, well-lit establishment, a place of community. Somewhere you eat with others, a universally unconscious sign of peace. Locations varying in light level and the concept of light itself play significant parts in Lynch's small town nightmare. Jeffrey's exposure to the dangerous forces that lurk in the shadows of Lumberton force a choice upon him. To cede to the darkness or to rise to the light, in other words, or in the words of Freud, to choose the superego or to fall for the id. Lynch presents such an interesting dichotomy of choice in Blue Velvet through these Freudian characterizations. Ostensibly, it's an obvious choice between who represents good and who represents evil, but as the film gains momentum and more is revealed, it begins to lean into an understanding of both sides. How can Jeffrey decide between the dark and the light when the yellow man is a detective playing both sides, when Dorothy seeks comfort in the abuse, and when Frank is simply an agent of impulse? Frank's actions are that of music, they are the definition of emotional impulses. He is unable to act without music, and for that he isn't a malicious character, but a simple representation of the darkest depths of our psyche. Likewise, the yellow man is someone caught between the two. He's clearly invested in his work as a detective, he dies for his cause, but he's still trapped indulging in Frank's lifestyle. Dorothy is a lot more complicated. She's hamstrung by her kidnapped son. And while she is abused by Frank, she's almost developed Stockholm syndrome. She doesn't hesitate to exact the same abuse on Jeffrey, and while she's clearly damaged, it's difficult to pinpoint where she truly stands. She, above all other characters, represents shades of darkness, almost like a fog. The darkness casting confusion over her, but veins of light and hope still shine through. It's these beautifully characterized and phenomenally acted pieces that build Lynch's puzzle. They substantiate Jeffrey's world and encapsulate him in a sea of ambiguity. When we meet him, he's simply a curious boy. When we leave him, he's somebody that's delved into the darkness of life. He's understood it and come to terms with it. For that is the only way as a society we can overcome it. After all, the robins of the light can kill the roaches of the darkness, but not without tasting that darkness first.
Stop.